I would like to welcome everyone to the MedStar Institute for Innovation's third annual Innovations in Thinking Differently Forum. My name is Mark Smith, and I'm going to be serving as your host today. It's absolutely great to have you here. And in keeping with the tradition we've had at our previous innovation forums of moving fast into content, I'm going to hold off making more formal welcoming remarks until after our first speaker. But what I will say is the following. Our goal, in the words of that great 60s group, the Mamas and the Papas, is to take you somewhere where you've never been before. And to quote, if I could have that first slide, the great one, that's Jackie Gleason. A little traveling music, please. Louder.
You're traveling through another dimension. A dimension not only of sight and sound, but of mind. A journey into a wondrous land whose boundaries are that of imagination. Your next stop, the Twilight Zone.
Thank you. Okay, you can cut that. And what we're going to be try to go to a somewhat separate space from our daily work, and hopefully you've recalibrated just a little bit, and that will set the kind of mood for me to tell you about a remarkable bootleg copy of a trailer for a new movie, a new underground movie, that just recently came into my possession. And you'll see in a moment why I'm going to share it with you. So without further ado, we could have the lights and the movie trailer, please. Thank you. So it gives me great pleasure to present our first speaker, Dr. Ed Tori. Ed is the director of presence, and that's presence with a C-E, not with a T-S, although I do think that you're going to find his presentation a great gift for the mind, and his topic, seduction artists, cult leaders, and con men, and how they can save healthcare.
Now, that is a very tough intro to follow. And I can tell you that that is really a bootleg copy that was made sort of on the fly just as a joke to circulate among ourselves. And then, even though I'm doing a talk on influence and persuasion in the influence section, I was manhandled into allowing that to be shown. So, and by the way, there were a couple other pictures I could have put up there of cult leaders and con men, you know, from amongst us, but I spared you all. So the topic you see there is seduction artists, cult leaders, and con men. And I'm going to try to stretch things quite a bit. I'm actually very nervous about giving this talk, and I'm OK sharing that up there. So I say that's a little bonding seduction strategy here. First, because this is going to be a stretch for the mind, I want to be a stretch for the body right now. So if everybody could put your shoulders back, take a deep breath in, and smile. And then do it again. Let it out. Deep breath in, shoulders back, smile. And now turn to someone at your table and say, I'm glad you're here. And I mean real smiles, not like you have gas. A real smile. Mean it. All right. Okay, so with that, we're going to get started. Here we go. Seduction artists, cult men, and cult leaders and con men, and how they can save healthcare. So have you ever, if you happen to be in clinical care, have you ever stood outside of a patient's room right before going in and heard the discussions where people are saying, oh my gosh, his family's horrible. His wife's a doctor. His brother's a pharmacist. You know, it's going to be a nightmare when you get in there. And then you end up going into the room and you have a completely different experience. It wasn't like that at all. Has that ever happened to you? How about, have you ever been sitting in a meeting where you're looking at the data? Maybe it's one of those red, yellow, and green report cards with all the, you know. And the first thing you do is you like turn to page 3 and look where your unit is, right? And you're, you know, all of us are doing this, right? And you're all green, so you're like, okay, I'm good. Or maybe there's a red one, and you have to start preparing how you're going to respond to that. You're getting ready for battle, right? Has that ever happened to you? Yeah. So there are lots of these situations where you'll find that if whatever it is you're tackling, if you're a VPMA and you're about to write a letter about hand washing to the medical staff, if you're a CNO and you have to start getting people to take one of the modules or something on Cytel, and you have to start to get buy-in for something, or maybe you are a nurse at the bedside dealing with what we call toxic family. Maybe you're a residency program director and you have to help residents get adjusted and acclimated to the somewhat hostile environment they're about to face in the first few weeks, right? So I'm going to show you that one of our dysfunctions in healthcare is that we tend to look only within healthcare. What's Mayo doing? What's Cleveland Clinic doing? What's Hopkins doing? Okay, then it's safe to do that. I'm going to tell you there are experts that are outside of our industries. And just like patient safety, you would look to what other industries can we look to that deal with unsafe environments, and what can we learn from them? What can we learn from the airline industry? What can we learn from the nuclear power industry? Just like that, I'm going to take you to another realm, and we're going to have a look at seduction artists, cult leaders, and con men. But just like Steven Johnson was just mentioning, for those of you that were able to see the video, I want to first walk you through my slow hunch. Now, he was talking about how ideas develop over years, and for those of you who were at this conference last year might remember someone in the audience, Dr. Hamilton, promising me that he wouldn't mention our little discussion about how I think we should look at seduction artists and cult leaders and con men for their rapport strategies. When I first said that in a room that was a small group, a small gathering, everybody laughed. Everybody laughed at it. But it was a slow hunch developing over time, so I'm going to show you how that slow hunch happened. Off to the left there, you'll see in very small font on purpose because it's just my early formative years. I was interested in art, science, and nature, and was a relatively good student. And when I made the decision to go into medicine, my AP European history teacher pulled me aside and said, "Damn it, Ed, you can't go into science. You're not supposed to be in some laboratory somewhere hugging an Erlenmeyer flask, writing stuff in a logbook. That's not you. You're a people person. And I'm worried about you going into college and studying these sciences and getting into that whole thing." And so his words really stuck with me. You're a people person. You need to be with people. And when I got to college, I found it to be such an amazing experience, mostly for the diversity and depth of experience you can have with people. So I was looking into cultures. I was learning other people's histories. I actually ended up graduating with a degree in African history. That's what my undergrad degree is before I went to med school. It made for interesting med school interviews, by the way. I'd walk in and they'd say, "Ed Tori?" Yeah, okay. Then they throw the file forward. Okay, why African history? So one of the things I did, I also had sort of a spiritual journey, which I won't go into now, but before, as I was entering that spiritual and religious journey, I studied cults beforehand because I didn't, did you ever walk into like an Amway meeting and, or something like where everyone's trying to recruit you? It feels weird. It's over the top. And I didn't want to be influenced by any of that stuff as I was on my spiritual journey. So I looked a little bit into the history of cults and what their strategies were. Then, of course, I ended up going into medical school, thank God. I don't know what I would have done with an African history degree. Probably teach, but anyway, I ended up going to medical school and ultimately did my residency and internship at MedStar Union Memorial Hospital. And along the way, I got really into medical humor. I just found like it made my day, it helped relieve some of the stress. I started capturing some medical bloopers that I would find on charts, and people were sending them from all over the hospital to contribute to that. And eventually my wife said to me, and I started posting it on websites back when, actually before Helix even had a website. My wife one day said, is there a way to monetize that? And I was like, I don't know. So I started looking at competitors and other people in medical humor space, and I found a way to monetize it. So then I started to get into building websites and building small web businesses. And I got in, and from there I started reading the literature on entrepreneurship. And from reading the literature on entrepreneurship and seeing that small tweaks in a headline or the color of a font could completely change the results, I started getting into marketing. I just fell in love with the discipline of marketing. From marketing, I started realizing some of this stuff I'm learning can be applied at the bedside. And so in relationships with the nurses, relationships with the social workers, the case managers, my attendings, all of these things started to slowly gel. And I started to realize that I was getting a lot of feedback about my rapport. And I'm going to back up here and go down to rapport. With rapport, when I was on my med school rotations before internship and residency, I had this one attending that was the most abusive person on the planet. The name of the hospital, it's now defunct, but the name of the hospital was Parkview. Everyone referred to it as Darkview, and it was because of this guy. Even when they handed me my pager to start this rotation, they're like, sorry, you have Dr. So-and-so. When I went around, he introduced me as his flea, his peon, his, you know, all kinds of words that I won't repeat from the stage. Very abusive to me, very abusive to the nurses, and I was burning out quickly. I would go home every night saying, I don't know if I'm cut out for this doctor thing. And my wife was like, stick with it, this is one rotation. You see how it is, it's so random. You get this guy, I get that guy. Next time you get so-and-so, you get so-and-so. And it's semi-random. And she said to me this phrase that I want, this is one of the main take-home points, so remember this. Take the good and leave the bad. So I started doing that when I went to this rotation. And one of the nurses actually came up to me and said, excuse me, how are you able to do this? You're smiling and you're walking around with this guy? And I said, my wife told me to take the good and leave the bad, and let's just say I'm leaving a lot behind. So, and he heard that, and he had the biggest smile, and that was the moment rapport happened. So from my med school rotations, I then started my residency, and one of my big-time clinical mentors is in the room right now, and he said something to me that transformed my training. He read a note that I had written. I was caring for a homosexual AIDS patient at the end of his life, and he had and I wrote a long note about why I wasn't going to talk about advanced directives, why I thought it was not the time right now, but I will address it before he's discharged. I didn't realize that A, anyone cared about an intern's notes, B, that it had such an impact, but my mentor, Dr. Wayne Campbell, pulled me aside and commented on how well written that note was and how the rapport was that I had established with that patient. He's an infectious disease physician. He had seen the patient as well. So it was that moment made me realize that I don't necessarily have to know the cause of XYZ or, you know, some rare disease on which chromosome somewhere. I mean, I do have to know it. I have to know where to find it. I have to know how to get it quickly. But there's other aspects of what we do that are important. Eventually, after training, I went to private practice, and this was, it ended up being a disaster for me because it was a recipe for burnout. But I absolutely fell in love with my patients. I wouldn't let anyone leave without trying to solve all their problems. But along the way, I noticed something. all of my patients, I had offices closer to D.C., one in D.C., closer to D.C., and one in Baltimore, just to keep my feet wet in both areas. I lived south. all of my patients except one quit smoking. It wasn't a lot of patients, but it was a striking number that I started to realize this rapport stuff, these influence strategies, these things are pretty powerful stuff. Eventually, I ended up becoming a hospitalist and sort of running the pre and post care for MedStar Union Memorial Open Heart Service. And I learned a lot from my patients there. This is what got me up in the morning, the time spent with my patients. And I noticed that they, all of them, by the way, think they're going to die before they go into heart surgery. And all of them think about the same three things. It doesn't matter what their gender is, what their race is, what their language is. They all think about the same three things. And it's God, family, and then relationships with people. And I mean, even random people. How did they treat the customer service rep at Walmart? Like, they're thinking about these things before they go in. And if we're just going in looking at our lab work, I realize if it's just lab work, just, you know, rates of, you know, survival rates and things like that, we miss this amazing moment. And soon, I started getting called for what were called patient whisperer consults. Hey, Dr. Tori, can you come see this guy? We just can't, he's just out of control. Can you just talk to him? I got a few of those from some of my mentors to go to a floor and start to try to rope someone in. And I'll tell you an interesting story a little bit later about how I actually used a strategy from hypnosis and seduction in order to bring someone who was screaming at everyone down to actually hug me at the end of the talk, at the end of the discussion. So with that, I want to talk about three archetypes real quick. The head, the heart, and the gut. And for you neuroscientists in the room, don't, you know, this is an archetype. This is a broad stroke thing here. When we use, in our everyday language, we talk about thinking and we talk about we think about the head and we use metaphors for the brain as a seat of thought, right? And when we talk about emotion and we talk about love and we talk about, you know, feelings and things like that, we talk about the heart. And when we talk about that intuition or blink, we talk about the gut, right? Now, the main point here is that look at our language, meaning us in healthcare. We say the lower brain, the reptilian brain. We refer to things like rapport and leadership and public speaking and, you know, these sort of things as soft skills. This is our language. Our language is, that's the reptilian brain. That's the lower brain. That's the lower self. But I'm telling you, when I look back at those open heart surgery patients, they weren't talking about data. They weren't talking about, you know, deep thoughts. They were talking about things from the heart, from the gut, okay? And when you look, we're going to take a quick glimpse through some of the worlds of other influencers, and we're going to see that they actually, most of their time is spent not on the head, actually subconscious, not conscious, and data and protocols and charts, but the next few layers down. Those things are important, and in fact, in hypnosis, they say, we lay the tracks with logic and reason. We move with emotion, okay? And even think about that, that moved me. That's sort of some of our language. So all of the influencers on the planet are operating below these, in the bottom half of the head archetype, and in the heart, and in the gut, all of them. So why aren't we? Okay, why aren't we? That is the point. And so you might say, yeah, but hold on. This is a little squirrely. You're getting into some ethics here. We can't coerce people into signing up for this surgery. We can't, you know, manipulate them into taking their medicines. Let me tell you something. I have kids, six of them, in fact. And my first three thought broccoli was a dessert. They really did. Now, I haven't figured out how to make the last three do it. It's just there's something about they talk, you know. But the first three thought broccoli was a dessert. Now, am I a bad parent? I never said broccoli was dessert. I made them feel like it was a dessert. One day we forgot the broccoli cooking, and my wife said, "Oh man, we forgot the broccoli." And I said, "Who wants broccoli?" And my wife and I both, "Me." And then we did that every time for 3, 4, 5 times. And eventually, we actually had to start serving the vegetables last, or else they wouldn't eat the other things of substance. If you look at, I'm talking about parenting now, but coaching, parenting, you know, running for office, whatever you're doing, leading a meeting, every single thing we do, our entire economy moves because people are influenced to take some sort of action. Okay, so we can talk about the ethics maybe in the question and answer. But influence, I like this definition: the capacity to have an effect on character, development, or behavior. Okay, the capacity to have an effect on character, development, or behavior. And what's interesting is it doesn't imply good or bad. It can be good or it can be bad, or it can be somewhere in between. And a little interesting tidbit, it actually comes from to flow into, since we're going to have a discussion on flow, and it originally comes from a phrase meaning emanating from the stars, and that's what influenza is actually its root. But with that, let's get back to the head, heart, and gut. Here we are crunching data, crunching charts. And by the way, if any of you see any images on there that are not mathematical in nature, shame on you. So there you go. That's typically where medicine is. But I want to show you that we're slowly moving away from that. You're going to start to see lots of things on the patient voice. And I think that's really important. The movement to share the patient voice is really important. But don't neglect our side of the rapport equation. And I think MedStar, with its latest branding, is really moving towards that. Look at that. Look at that phrase, knowledge and compassion focused on you, right? It's not about us. It's about you. And it's knowledge, head, and compassion, heart. We're getting there. And I think, and by the way, that I just happened to notice that while I was preparing the talk. And this was a note I had written to myself. The best influencers influence themselves first. They exhibit cognitive empathy, meaning they can walk a mile in someone else's shoes. They can be that unconscious, competent person doing their thing, the superstar nurse, or you know, or whatever the task is, and they can step back and experience what others are experiencing, the person that's consciously incompetent, and et cetera. They can step back and experience that. And then they cater to others' self-interest. That is the key. And they practice influence. They practice influence. So you can't mention influence without mentioning this book, Influence, The Psychology of Persuasion by Dr. Robert Cialdini. In it, he talks about psychological triggers. By the way, there are many more than these six, but these are the six that are focused on there. If you were to buy one book, that's the book I would recommend if you wanted to learn about influence a little more. But in it, he talks about these six psychological triggers. Authority, meaning people in positions of authority or perceived positions of authority, are more likely, their requests are more likely to be complied with. Liking, you're more likely to be influenced by people you like or have something in common. Reciprocity, you give something, if somebody gives something to you, there's an inner, you feel compelled to return in some way. Social proof. This one's an interesting one, and I want to focus on it for a minute because I see us make so many mistakes in social proof. Social proof says that, let's say you're in a moment of uncertainty, and you will tend to look to people like yourself and then do what they do. If I all of a sudden took off my pants right now, that would be a moment of uncertainty. You'd be like, what the heck is this guy doing? Like, okay? You would all look to each other like, what's the best way to behave? Is this a joke? Like, I don't really know this guy. Is this real? So you will look to people around you. When you're driving down the road and two people in front of you put on their turn signal and move over, you move over. It's counterintuitive because you're getting into the lane that's more crowded. You're not necessarily thinking about it, but that social proof, it's a moment of uncertainty. Do they know something I don't know up ahead? And you move over. Okay, that's social proof. And this is used a lot by others, by some of the folks I'm going to mention in a few minutes. But this is where we go wrong. Social proof is really interesting. I went to my primary care doctor office not too long ago because I was about to start Insanity, some workout program, right? And I wanted to make sure that I was safe to do that because I'm 40. I turned 40 in 2 months. So there's a sign on his wall that says 7 out of 10 hypertensives are uncontrolled. When I looked at that, I thought, wow, that's 70% of people are not controlled. That is actually, if I'm a patient and I'm sitting there, I'll be like, yeah, man, I'm okay. I'm like 70% of the people. Now, when studied, this is studied in a lot of different disciplines. There's one example in one of the influence books that goes over tax fraud. They wanted to decrease tax fraud. So they said, because of all the tax fraud out there, we're going to increase penalties. And the moment they did, tax fraud went up. It went up even though the penalties went up. Why? Because of all the tax fraud out there. So what do we do when we do hand washing? Because of all you doctors not washing your hands, we're going to have to do XYZ. We have to be very careful about how we say that. Instead, we should flip it and say, if even one of you doesn't wash your hands and the JCO police are behind, we're going to be, you're just saying you flip it. You don't go, all of you are not washing your hands. You flip it to even one of you. Scarcity is when there's scarce resources, you want it more. Another way is urgency if you put a time element on it. You have to act right now or else. So that's another element. And then commitment and consistency is another one that the influencers use a lot, is that the moment you start down a path, let's say you verbally commit to it, you write it down, or you say something publicly, you are more likely to remain on that. So, and I'll show you examples of that from the seduction world. Now, another book I want to mention, if you don't want to read studies on psychology and influence, buy the book, Yes, 50 Scientifically Proven Ways to Be Persuasive. Same author or contributor, but it's more chunkified and easier to read. And then another one on, another book I would recommend is Influencer, The Power to Change Anything. That group of authors focuses on behavior, not just psychological triggers. So now, one of the things that I didn't mention in my slow hunch is that over time, when I wanted to learn something, I'd try to find people and go stay with them for a little while, 3 days, 4 days, and learn how they see the world. So I did that with iPhone game designers, did that with hypnotists, did that with, actually next month I'm going to meet a conversational hypnotist. So I just go and learn from them, see how they see the world. And so we're going to dive into a couple other masters. Now I want to reframe this whole con artist thing. And I realized con men in the title is really, we should have said con artists, but I want to reframe them because in order for us to learn from them, we have to get that negative feeling out of our head. And that is, they are masters of trust. Think about it. How could they possibly get someone to give up their money or their property or things like that? How could they possibly give up something that's so dear, something that we're starting off trying to protect it? Okay, so many of you know, I hope, Bernie Madoff, he had $50 billion. He conned out of people over a period of 30 years. He used authority because he was the head of NASDAQ for a while. He also sat on a bunch of boards. Another way of using authority is to borrow it. So oftentimes he was very selective about who was the first person he got to use the to get in on the game here, to invest with him, in quotes. He was very selective about who, because if he got that person, then he could get that person and that person and that person. Okay, it's sort of secret societies work the same way. They say, let's get that person and then all these others will follow through. So now, he often said no to his clients. Dr. Smith walks up to me and say, Ed, I want to invest in your thing. I say, no, I don't think you should. It's, this is a select group of people, whatever. The moment you turn around and you say, you know what, I'm not like the other people, I want to, that's commitment and consistency. So pull away, this is a strategy of the influencers. They pull away so that you come running, okay? And that hits that psychological trigger of commitment and consistency. The other is the liking piece. Every single description of Mr. Madoff describes him as like a member of the family. That's one of the most common repeated phrases of the people who were describing what it was like to be swindled. He felt like a member of the family. He had charm, he had trust, he had intimacy, and eventually you got into the club by being able to call him Bernie, okay? And his exceptions were favors. So remember reciprocity? It's not only if I give you a gift, if I give you a flower in the airport so that you give a donation to my society, it's also if I get you to withhold something, okay? So if a Boy Scout comes up and says, can you donate to our Boy Scout thing? And then can you donate $10 to the thing? And you say no. I say, okay, will you buy a candy bar for a dollar? That's reciprocity. It's an inverse of it. You feel compelled to give a favor because they sort of took one for the team by when you said no for the $10. So he did the same thing. He would say, you shouldn't invest with me. You can't invest with me. Okay, fine, I'll let you into the club. But the moment he lets you into the club, it's couched as a favor. Cult leaders, masters of groups and cultures. So many of you know of the Jonestown experience. Construction on that site began in 1970 in South America. This was not a religious movement, by the way. This was a political. It started out, he was inspired by how much money people were giving at a faith healing session, and then later started a church, but ultimately it ended up becoming sort of a civil rights movement combined with a socialist movement combined with somebody in charge who wanted to basically lead people astray in a very big way. It culminated with, in November 1978, 9 people were murdered when a delegation went to visit the site. And ultimately, 909 people died in a mass suicide. 303 of them were children. Now, how did that happen? One of the things that happened here is that he calculated the control of the culture. So environment was controlled. They moved to a new place. Communication was controlled. What you could say, what you couldn't talk about, these sort of things. Access to information. The daily needs, even who employed, who didn't, how they were employed, what jobs they had. Shame and guilt. They had to admit certain faults that they had that were then later used on them in another way. The culture of the group around was such that you couldn't dissent. And there was an us versus them. We're not like them. This is us, and it strengthens the bond. And then there were a lot of work on language patterns and frames, reframing things. Just like I'm reframing a con artist as a master of trust and a cult leader as a master of groups, they would reframe other things. In particular, Jim Jones would reframe other things so that his people followed him. And now, when you look in, this is the problem. When you look in the heads of the people who are victims of a cult, one of the biggest problems is a self-serving bias. And that is that we have a tendency to think of ourselves as slightly more attractive than the other person, slightly more skilled at such and such. I'm not likely to fall victim to a cult. I'm not likely to fall for a pickup artist. This is the self-serving bias. And this is actually a very dangerous bias, and everyone in this room has an element of it. Now let's look at pickup artists, and I want to focus a little more on this because I think there's more applications. That picture there is Neil Strauss. Has anyone heard of Neil Strauss? I know everyone, this is one of those raise the hand fail moments because no one's gonna raise their hand and say, yeah, I heard of that pickup artist. But he actually happens to be a pretty famous author for New York Times. He tried to do an expose and ended up being seduced by the community. He went in to learn about the lifestyle and the communication strategies of pickup artists and studied from as many pickup artists as he could and then came up with his own formulation and actually ended up becoming what many consider to be the best pickup artist alive at the time. And so he wrote quite a bit about it. So in general, their steps are open, meaning the approach of the person and get them, establish a connection. Demonstrate some sort of value. So open is get their attention. Okay. And by the way, magicians are masters of attention. So, and we can cover that another time. So they often use magic for that first first and next couple steps. So open the target. They refer to them as a target. We refer to ours as a patient. They refer to them as a target. Open. Okay, I'm going to show you that there's a lot of borrowed language, by the way. I'll show you where we fall short. So open the target, demonstrate value to the target, then create an emotional connection, and then create a physical connection, and escalate along the way. Now, here are some other steps. So those are the four basic steps, and you could read those, you know, probably anywhere. But here's one of the things. The more you look into it, the more it's completely amazing how much they thought about this stuff. And so the first is to go first. The feeling of go first, that's common in hypnosis. It's common in NLP. I don't know if you've ever heard of neuro-linguistic programming. It's common in all of the influence industries. They all go first. And that is, you have to influence yourself first. If you want to come up here and wow the crowd, you have to be excited first. If you want to convince someone in a meeting, you have to be convinced first. You can't compel someone until you are first compelled. They know that so well that they broke it down into what they call Las Vegas. And that is an acronym for certain things that they want to be before they ever enter what they call a set. Now, a set is when they walk into this room. Now, let's say it's the break period, and everybody's standing around, and it's after this talk, and you're standing around sipping water, getting coffee, doing whatever. A pickup artist walks in the room. The pickup artist can immediately assess this group. Who's who? Who do they need to influence first? Who are the obstacles to influence? How do I remove those obstacles? How do people feel about each other, and what are those relationships? They can know it instantly. They are unconsciously competent at that skill. All right? What if I walk into a patient's room and the wife is a doctor? Can I do that? Am I unconsciously competent at assessing who do I need to influence first? All right? So they observe. Observation is key. When we walk into a patient's room, do we see the pictures on the mantle? Do we see the things they've written? What do the cards say? What kind of tattoos does the guy have? What shirt is his daughter wearing? Is there any connection point? They observe that immediately. That's one of the first things. Then they observe the target. Now the target, by the way, is the one they want to pick up, right? Well, if that person is extremely gorgeous, they will approach that person obliquely. They will go after the rest of the set. If I want to win over Mark Smith, I want to seduce Mark Smith, I'm going to seduce the crowd first. Okay? I'm going to go to the people that he sees the social proof of the entire crowd liking me. All right? So that's sort of how it works. So they have all these phrases, and each of these is deep underneath each one. I mean, the opening, addressing obstacles, the way they address obstacles, the way they deal with people who are in the way, so to speak. There's an immense amount we can learn from. Running routines. So they might have a certain routine. I'll give you an example. I have. Have you ever faced a patient where the husband is like Archie Bunker, like, oh, I don't care about other stuff. These damn doctors just want to make money. And the wife is like, Harold, look, they're here to help you. Will you shut up? You're nagging me, right? How do you win rapport with both of them at the same time? You can. And here's how. One of my routines that I run at the bedside is that Harold and, well, let's just say, you know, Archie and Edith are sitting there. I'll say, look, Harold, or Archie, let's just go with Archie. Archie, look, you know, Mr. Bunker, you know what? My wife says that I have man's disease. You know, I don't see things that are right on the counter right in front of my face. I don't ask for directions when we're out. But I don't tell her about concerning symptoms either. And, you know, sometimes, I know what it's like to be nagged or someone in your ear asking about that. But, you know, the whole time I'm saying, yeah, my husband's got man disease. You see her looking like, yep, mm-hmm. Archie's got man's disease. But he's also connecting because, wow, you also have that problem? You know, we see eye to eye. You can establish rapport immediately. And pickup artists are, and I'm not a pickup artist, by the way. Let's establish that. That's a little disclaimer. And then the other thing mentioned, fractionating rapport. So they fractionate rapport. They move in, move back. Move in, move back. That's an important strategy because the pickup artist is actually not picking up anyone. They're turning it around so that they're being picked up. That's the key to commitment and consistency, and that's how they do it. They fractionate the rapport. Rapport isn't being real nice. It's being real, okay? That is the difference. And so to be real, a real person isn't like the people you meet at an Amway meeting. A real person is somebody who, you know, has real feelings. And they're not always all positive, you know, the whole way, always giving compliments, okay? So it's not always about being nice. They give false time constraints. Which they might say, look, I can't really talk right now, I gotta get back to my friends, but I have a quick question. So that's how they give a false time constraint, it immediately disarms. So that is one of their strategies for disarming. A woman that's out that doesn't wanna be picked up by somebody or some creep, right? All of a sudden, he's trying to win over the crowd, so she sees that everybody's into him. Not only that, there's this, when he does interact with her, open, the set, they call it. When he does, he gives a false time constraint, like, I'm not sticking around. Okay, so don't worry, I'm not here to do anything. So then they have other things that I'll mention. Bouncing. Bouncing is taking someone from one setting to another setting to another setting to another setting, and all of a sudden you feel like you knew the person for a long time. There's a sense that time has passed, but it really hadn't. And that's usually the way you feel when you're doing something you enjoy. So you look back on it with enjoyment. Then there's different types of closes. The way to end an encounter is they have different ones with different strategies. And then later, they assess the results and they share it in their community. Okay, almost like talking about, unfortunately, a sporting event. They share the results of the rapport establishing strategies with each other. Now, some of the things off to the right you see there, micro-calibration, cat string theory, neg theory. Neg theory is really interesting to me. Because neg theory, a neg is, it's almost putting down somebody. So imagine somebody trying to pick up somebody that's maybe she's considered a 10, very gorgeous, whatever. She's used to people constantly hitting on her, especially in the setting that a pickup artist would be working, like a bar or a club or whatever. She's used to people coming up hitting on her. So what does he do? The opposite. If this is the woman, he'll talk to the group like this, slight body language, shoulder, talk to her like this. Oh, who brought her? Oh, are those nails real? You know, they're nice. Okay, subtle put down. It's not, oh, those nails real? Oh, that's nice. Yeah, they're nice. Or right after she talks, offer her gum. Okay, so these are, they have, now, what's interesting is this neg theory is they do this to fractionate rapport more, and also to be somebody that is different than all the others, okay? So so neg theory is something we can talk a little bit more about. Cat string theory is like a cat, if you ever saw a cat batting at a string, the moment you drop it, it's like, well, whatever. Like, I don't want it anymore. They're playing with it. And so they have theories on how that is and how to elicit that sense of play. So anyway, and then IOI are indicators of interest. So they talk about the shape of the face, the raising the eyebrows, the flicking of the hair, all these different body language cues that indicate interest. And then they have all these other cues that indicate disinterest. And what they do is they calibrate. They turn a needle back and forth during the interaction. So instead of saying every woman is like every other woman, they say, no, every instance is unique, and I'm going to calibrate it using all these strategies until I find the sweet spot, okay? All right, so that's the pickup artist. I'm going to zip through a couple of these things. Now, some other influence industries that are important. Marketing, sales, people who write things, politicians, clergy, hypnotists, NLP practitioners, people who design games, copywriters. Now, copywriters, I'm going to show you an example of copywriting. But copywriters are basically people who write the things that you see, whether you're reading a paragraph on the back of a cereal box or you're reading one of those letters that, you know, normally you would throw out, but it's like, you know, 321 ways to whatever, da, 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 and you get this long letter, it's 8 pages, it's in the mail, it's addressed to you, and copywriters are the ones that write that. That's direct response marketing. Lobbyists, trial lawyers, charities that are trying to raise money, coaches, parents, media. These are influence industries, and what's different about them from us is that they know their job is to influence. They practice it. They have books about it. We don't have a lot of books about it. So let me show you this. The difference between all of these practitioners, I hope, can be explained by this chart. Do the ends justify the means? You know, we all know that phrase. By ends, I'm talking actually about the beginning, the intention. The intention, what are they intending to get out of it? So what ends are they intending to get versus what skills do they have in influence? And when you plot these people on the chart, now we don't really care about the people who are bad, have bad intentions and are bad at influencing because those people just sort of weird us out, right? So we're going to ignore them. Instead, we're going to focus here and look at these different things. Now, I put some things here. PUA, PUA, is actually the term for a pickup artist. And by the way, they refer to the rest of us as AFCs, Average Frustrated Chumps. So these are real terms they have. They have their own language. So, but the PUA is down here, right? They have bad intentions, the lowest, almost the lowest. I purposely didn't put them all the way down there because somewhere Jim Jones and these others are, they're down there. But their skills, they're far to the right. They have mastered a way for people to give up intimacy. And we can't get people to take statins, right? So there's stuff to learn there. Now, what about these other things? I think parents and coaches and those sort of things, they're great. They're good intentions and so-so. I mean, they fall on a spectrum. You know, you could imagine these dot all over. There's good parents, there's bad parents. But in general, for the most part, most have good intentions. Healthcare, I think we have good intentions for the most part. Eventually, some people can become jaded. Some people can only become about the numbers because that's all we talk about are the numbers. But most of us went into this and at the end of the day feel good because we're helping people. And we went into this to help people. So our intentions are good, but our skills are not. They're not. And so, actually, let me back up there. I want to show you a quick video.
What did you do to my sign?
I wrote the same, but in different words.
Thanks, love.
So that demonstrates the power of copywriting. It was a very touching film, right? And it also demonstrates the power of cinematography, but for how we responded. But the actual content of the video demonstrates the power of copywriting. You change the words, and you can completely change the response. All right? So quickly, I want to go over some things that influencers know that we don't. Influence is about managing states. Okay, it's about managing states. It's not about compliance. It's not about getting someone to do what you said. It's about managing their emotions. Okay, that thing that I had at the beginning, the archetypes, all of the influencers are about moving the emotions. So change the moods and the minds will follow. This is a mantra of all of the influence industries, all of them. Change the moods and the minds will follow. And how you ask your questions changes the answers you get, okay? I can give a simple example. I was really struggling with a nurse practitioner I worked with several years ago to make this one schedule. And she was like, I can't work that day. I can't work that day. There's no way I can't work that day. No matter what, I have such and such, I have such and such, I can't work that day. I was, you know, about to lose it. And I don't lose it very often at work. I was really nearing the end because it was like, I can't work that day. All right. And then I finally said, I'm not asking you if you can work that day. I'm asking, how can we get this day covered? And you know, she went from the most annoying person on the planet to come up with the most creative solution possible. It was some bizarre, like, five-way switch. I mean, it was amazing. And it was changing the question. So influencers know this. Small changes can mean big results like that video there. And then intentions, sincerity, and integrity are visible. They're visible. And we need to observe to know when it's there and when it's not. And our patients are experts at this. Why? They're vulnerable. When you're vulnerable, authenticity detectors that you used, Mark? When you're vulnerable, or your loved one is vulnerable, your authenticity detectors are on high. So if you come in and you're talking about, you know, yeah, we're going to send you for x-ray, and your body language is all saying something else, or you're talking like this as you're walking out, your body language, your cues, your facial expressions, all that stuff is obvious. It is the language of rapport, and we need to know it. We need to understand it. We need to be able to speak it. Now, what do influencers have that we don't? Influence industries have that we don't? They view psychology and emotion as central, and every single participant, every single actor in that industry is responsible for knowing it. It's not some specialty you call on. You don't call on the patient whisperer consult. That's the wrong way to do it. All of us should be practitioners of rapport in all of our settings. Their language, they have their own language for influence. They have their own constructs. And I'll show you a quick example of that. They have their own metrics, and they're deep metrics. You know, we tend to think in healthcare that, the data that we need is in the electronic record. There's a lot of metrics to be found in marketing. There's a lot of metrics to be found in, you know, what's the no-show rate to your clinic? Does that have anything to do with recent posts on Twitter or the presidential debate or whether the O's win or not? I mean, these things, there's a lot of other data points that we miss because we look at other healthcare, other people in healthcare, and define our data sets in that realm. There's a whole bunch of data coming in through your eyes, through your ears, and through a sense that you have when you're in any sort of group that we're leaving on the table, and they don't. The influencers don't. They share their influences, successes, and failures. They share them. They say, you know what? I had trouble with a patient like that before, and this is how I handled it. I don't know if that'll help, but you can try it. We don't have that conversation very often. Instead, we're outside saying, his wife's really a jerk. You know, stay away from her. She's one of those frustrated, you know, whatever. And you start going off, you hear this whole conversation, and then you're going in ready for battle. We need to change that conversation. Influence efforts by the influence industries are not focused on completion. Okay? It's not a task they have to finish. They don't have to get the med there by 8:30. They have to make the patient feel good about addressing their health. Okay? The difference between compliance and, you know, where I think we should be is, do we get patients to comply or do we get them to make healthy decisions? That's the difference. Okay? The other thing is, they build in adaptability. They don't read from a rote script and say, well, Mr. Jones, I'm sorry you feel that way. We know that. You hear that you call in customer service at Verizon or something. Man, you just want to reach right through, right? Well, they build in adaptability. They calibrate. Just like the pickup artist is calibrating, so too are all the other influencers when they're interacting with anybody. So we look at data in aggregate, and we say diabetics benefit from this medication. But when we're at the individual level, we should be micro-calibrating that message, okay? And the other thing, this last piece is important. They enjoy it. They enjoy the act of influence. They enjoy it. They sometimes even gamify it. And you see it in charities. They'll have a little thermometer that's filling up with money. They enjoy, and they make a game of it, make a game of things. We don't do that, okay? Now, what do we do? Well, there's a book called The Medical Interview. And every time I try to look up interviewing patients, the medical interview comes up, and this is no reflection on the authors. I just want to show you a couple comments here. If you have ever had a conversation with another human, you don't need this book. This book is a piece of duty. Do not buy this book. Did I say that wrong? Duty, duty, duty. All right. Do not buy this book. It seems as if it were written for robots to teach them how to interact with human patients. If you have any social skills whatsoever, you do not need this book. All right? Most of the easily accessible information that I can find on rapport in healthcare, if it's not coming from patients and the patient voice, where is it coming from us? When it comes from us, it's obvious. We're making up acronyms in some committee that says, oh, it's heart, hearing, empathy. We're just making these things up. But we have experts in our midst that we could tap into. Let me show you, the pickup artist is not the expert in our midst, at least I hope there's none of them in our midst. But let me show you, this is an example of the medical interview juxtaposed to the pickup artist opening a set or going after their target. There's huge gaps in here. They do stuff before they get there that we aren't even considering. They do stuff in the middle. And there's so many things in here and afterwards that we are missing. This is where we need a whole body of literature, of simulation training, and of instruction. And so that's my premise to you today. Some influences among us that I think we should tap into, and sometimes we do them wrong. Marketing communications. When you think about marketing communications for healthcare, they know the market. They know the people. For us to walk in and say, I need a flyer for my orthopedics thing. What? How do you know you need a flyer? Who is your market? The marketers are the ones that can help you, guide you through that. They'll ask questions. But instead, we go through with a task. Here's our task for you. Here's our task. And so other people among us. So marketers, Gene's going to be speaking today. You have, Stephanie Johnson, Johnny Hagerman. These people are available to us daily. And I'm not saying we're not going to swamp your offices, Gene, but I am saying we should learn from the marketers and the communicators, the therapists. There's all kinds of different types of therapy where, people are being coached through things. There's coaching. There's trainers. Maggie's here. She teaches leadership training. Jim is here. He teaches leadership training for executives. I mean, these people are right here. They're in this room. Why aren't we learning from them? Why aren't we tapping them for influence strategies? Philanthropy, anytime there's negotiations, people that are parents, anyone who's good at public speaking, anyone who's good at teaching, these people have skills. We should talk about what made that good, what made that bad. Ed, after this, I want to hear Ed. What was great about your talk was this. What sucked was this. And I think you should work on this. That will help me. Okay?
Your praise of marketing was fabulous.
Thank you. So, in your work, where might you be able to apply this? Some of these strategies that I've talked about. Now, even in NEG, let's talk about the NEG theory really quickly. That concept of putting someone down slightly, I actually tried it on someone famous, not in a pickup kind of way, just in a, it was after a conference. There was a large group of people saying, oh my God, can you sign my book? Can you sign this book? And I want to talk to you, and blah, 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 all groveling over him. And so I happened to be standing there, and I really had an important question that I wanted to ask him. And so I was standing there, angled my back to him, just enough, slightly cocked it, and turned over and said, I appreciate that, blah, 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 blah. And I sort of gave him a backhanded compliment, meaning it was a compliment, but it was over my shoulder. The body language was such that, you know what, yeah, good. I appreciated that insight kind of thing. Immediately, he came over to me. He broke from the crowd and came and talked to me and then walked me to my hotel room before I went into my hotel room and he went into his. But the point is, I think he could have just been using it as, that guy's like not like these other grovelers, and this is my out. Yes. I can get back to my room. But the point is, how did he know it? It was body language. All right. So in your work, where can you apply some of these things? Whatever your work is, wherever it is in healthcare, how can you apply some of these things? And I'm going to, and you see that these are all trees emanating from that heart, head, heart, gut archetype. But quick exercise. If you could, in paper that you have written or in your little books that you got, these are just three examples. But write down three things that you'll commit to adding to your day-to-day influence. Three things. Maybe you'll try to go first. Maybe you'll pump yourself up before you go into the patient's room. Maybe you'll assume the best in those patients before you get in there and ignore the conversation and get in there and get ready before you go in. Maybe you'll look at your questions a little better. Maybe before you put out the survey or before you send out that email. Maybe you'll change the subject line, because your subject line is how your email's even going to get read. Okay? So actually, there was one time I had to, I see Jill in the audience, I'm going to single you out. One time I really had to reach her for something. I went to her office. She was in there on the phone, and I didn't want to interrupt. So I went back to my office, and I sent her an email. And it said, I was just outside your office. That was the subject line. The subject line could have been RE colon. It could have been, you know, some, you know, grant proposal or whatever it was. But instead it was, I was just outside your office. Is she going to open that? Of course. Now, it wasn't manipulation. It was, Jill and I are cool. We're cool. but you get it. So you can change your subject lines. You can change the way you phrase things. You can make those micro adjustments that can completely change the outcome, like that person asking for money on the street, right? So fractionating rapport, observing for context. When you go into a room, look at the pictures, look at the wallet, the wallet size photos of the kids, and you know, what are they watching on TV? You know, there may be signs there. Fractionating rapport, pacing and leading and matching and mirroring, I was gonna cover, I will not cover those right now, but I'm just saying, I listed these as examples. What can you do? Did you get anything from this talk? And if you did, write down some of it that you're going to do. So my final words to you are that our job is to influence. And although Mark revealed that bootleg copy that said, second, do no harm, first, seduce, really, it's second, do no harm, first, influence. Okay? First, influence. So with that, I will take questions. So Terry's question was, can you tell us how you got all of your patients to in your office to quit smoking? I will say this, that I did, the first is that it was a small group, okay, you know, about 100, okay? But it's still pretty good numbers. I will also say that the only one that bugs me is that one person that didn't. And I saw her a year ago, and I went up to her in her room, I said, Mrs. H., please tell me you're not smoking. And she said, no, I'm still smoking, Dr. Tori. And I said, ah. I said, and then I tried to use social proof. I said, you're the only one of all of my patients. You're the only one that's still smoking. I still have been unable to. And she's not my patient anymore, but I see her occasionally. So it was micro calibration. It was each person is an individual. And changing it to what influences them. It's the difference between saying, like in heart surgery, you know, Mr. Jones, you know, we have great outcomes at this facility, and we think you're going to do fine. Our surgeon, you're in great hands with our surgeons. Versus saying, or let's say at that moment you're saying all these things about your facility, and then you say, but it will be really important for you to stop smoking afterwards. Instead, to turn it around and sort of look around the room and see, oh, you have grandchildren. Oh, yeah, what's it like to play? Oh, imagine what it's like. Imagine life 10 years from now. What's it going to be like playing with your grandchildren? What would it be like if you weren't smoking? What would that be like? You bring in something from their world. And there's lots of other ways of doing that, but I'm just saying it's the micro-calibrating along the way. So, and I wish I recorded it all better. It was back, I was just out of training. I, I didn't think, I also didn't think it would work, by the way. But, so any questions? Yeah.
As I was listening to this, I was thinking about how society just seems to be constantly trying to get a grip on this by constantly polling, surveying. I mean, we look at the national polls and in politics, it's every day. Even at MedStar, we poll our patients, we poll our physicians, we poll our associates, all looking for this major influence. Now, when I look at things, it's pretty much from the view of an orthopedic surgeon, which is basically get down to the bone and stay there. And I just wonder how we can leverage this to get our patient satisfaction scores up. I mean, it can't be just groupthink that, you know, here in the East our scores are lower and in the Midwest they're higher. How do we influence our patients to think we're doing a better job?
Right. That is a superb question. How can we use influence strategies to impact patient experience by itself and therefore patient experience numbers? If you just did that first thing, go first, if everyone in this room did that, it will completely change the dynamic of our interactions. Before a hypnotist goes into a hypnosis session, they prepare by getting themselves where they want their audience to be. Before a neurolinguistic programmer does it, they do the same thing. Before a comedian gets on stage, they're not reading depressing news articles before they go on stage. They're amping themselves up. They're getting their game face on. We should be doing that in every single one before we get into one of these interactions, especially when people have heightened authenticity detectors. You need to be there or else they'll know you're not there. So we need to go first. And for each person, that might be a different way. But if we just did that one strategy and worked on how can we do it, if we can reframe that discussion that's happening at the nurse's station, like, well, wait a minute, you know, I understand they're upset. Well, maybe she's not a jerk. Maybe she's actually a classic example. Here's an example of in India, Pakistan, Bangladesh, the way to say yes is this, okay? To nod the head like this. One time I was in a discussion at the nurse's station before going into a patient's room. This guy's wife is completely unreasonable. She's saying he's in pain, he's not in pain. She's constantly at the nurse's station asking for pain medicine. I was going in prepared to, you know, say, but I was preparing for your husband saying he's not in pain. You're saying he's in pain. We have to respond to your husband. This is what I was preparing for before I went in. And when I went in, it wasn't that at all. It's that, are you in pain, Mr. So-and-so? Yes. And so it was being documented as zero. I think we should assume the best before we get into any interaction. Whether it's at a meeting and you're about to sit there and you say, oh God, she's at this meeting, so I can't say it. You know, how many times did we sit in a meeting and we didn't say anything? We should sort of structure how we say things, but also assume the best in other people and go up afterwards if we feel wronged in some way. We should be able to have that open dialogue. And until we do, if you have an argument in one place and then go to see a patient, it's all over you. You know, it's written all over your body and all over your face. We need to be able to control our emotions and guide them and direct them so that our body reflects it. And I think that one strategy alone, you will see the numbers go up.
One question. Why do you think we don't do what you're describing in healthcare? Why do you think that's ubiquitous across healthcare in general?
I think there's a pendulum. And right now we're on the data protocol, hyper-analyze pendulum, end of this thing. And right now, we're misusing data. We're abusing it. We're taking a look at all of our data coming in through the electronic record. What time did that nurse give that medicine? That's got to be in by 8:30, even though it's a once-a-day drug, or whatever time it is, once-a-day drug, right? We're looking at the data saying, who's violating this policy that we made, okay? Instead of saying, let's look at it in aggregate. Wait a minute. Wow, 40% of the nurses are giving it after 8:30. Maybe something else is going on. Maybe our time is random, just like 3 days, 7 days, 10 days of antibiotics. You know, so we're misusing that data. And we also have this sort of, we almost worship our own career, in the sense that we look, or not our career, but our domain. It's in healthcare. This is healthcare. This is different. This isn't like the airline industry. We can't learn safety from the airline industry. This is healthcare. This is different. We can't learn rapport strategies from pickup artists. So we do that in every realm. We're constantly only looking within healthcare for answers. We need some intersectional thinking. Have we ever thought about, you know, we're trying to tackle falls in the hospital? Well, who struggles with falls? What about construction workers? Do they do anything different? Maybe can we learn from them? Well, it's just, I'm just pulling that out at random. I mean, there are so many things we can learn from. And also, the culture in our organizations has to be such that, you know what, Sally is good at XYZ and Joey is good at such and such. Those talents that are not in their job descriptions, those are gold mines. They might be experts in something, sitting there, toiling in the fields, and we miss them because we don't let their voice come out. We actually stop it. That won't work here.
Ed, thank you. That was indeed wonderful. Go first. One of the challenges I see of Go First, all the con men, all the artists that you cited have personal gain as their ultimate goal. There's something they're doing either monetarily or spiritually or emotionally that is pleasing them. It's one thing to be thinking Go First when you walk into the room, but I know why you do it, because you're passionate about this. That comes through in your talk, but not everybody in medicine carries your degree of passion. My challenge is how do you get the person before they walk in that room to go first into that room because of the patient and the influence that they want to have and not themselves? When we get busy, when we get tired, when we get frustrated, we don't take that time. We go into the room, we do a basic job. But how do we change, how do we, each time we walk into the room, how do we convince ourselves that we're going first in there, not for us, but for that particular patient? And then how do we make that a reward to us? Because there's got to be something that comes back.
Okay. Yeah, that's a superb question. The first piece is that realize that most, and this is a theory that's sometimes controversial, but I happen to agree with it, that most of the time we are moving toward pleasure or away from pain. In everything we do, we're moving toward pleasure or away from pain. And if we can get in tune with why we're actually doing something. Okay, so for example, now most of the people in this room have that sort of self-serving bias that I mentioned before, that and myself included, that I'm not going to be influenced by that. I'm looking at the numbers. I'm looking at the data. I see that this is what I have to do. This patient will benefit from aspirin. This patient needs a duplex scan. So, but what happens if you miss a DVT? When you miss a DVT, in the few days to weeks, maybe a couple months, you're like overshooting. You're ordering that ultrasound of the lower extremities probably a little more than the data would tell you. Why do we do that? It's because we move toward pleasure and away from pain. And in that instance, we're trying to move away from pain. We don't want to miss the DVT. But what if we could shift it and make it so that our patient interactions are pleasurable? What if that going in there is fun, engaging? That is really what it is. So the first thing is we have to change our language. We're calling it a patient interview. Interview, inter, between, view, look, look between. But to engage or to connect is something bigger. We need to change our language so that we're referring to things, you know, not as the reptilian brain, the lower brain, but in a way that will start to shape our own feelings about these events. That's one. Two, we need to select people, the right people. You know, just like a you know, a patient can detect authenticity when somebody walks into their room. We should be doing that when we're selecting our residents and our nurses and we're hiring and we're doing these things. I don't care what their CV looks like. How do they interact with people? All of these skills are learned, okay? But some people have had a lot more practice coming in. So we can either put all the resources to train the people to be able to do this, or we can start selecting the right ones from the beginning. So I think it needs to be both. And the first step is for ourselves to do it, especially if you're in a position of leadership, especially if you're in a position of teaching, is to practice it. Once you practice it, I'm telling you, this is intoxicating. When people will call me to another floor and say, look, I know he's not your patient, I'm sorry, I know you're busy, can you just go in and calm this guy down? That's intoxicating. It really is. After you're able to win someone over, get them to feel good again, even if it's somebody that thinks I'm going to die, and you get them to see the hope and see the opportunity and what's before them, that moment, that click, we have to try to feel that. And so I think we're just too data and task oriented. Those are important. The tasks we have to complete and the data we gather and use to make decisions. But that's not what moves us. What moves us are emotions. And the only way to know, the only way for us to change is for us to be in tune with and honest about our emotions. And I don't know if I answered that. It's a very roundabout way of answering, but emotion is the key. We marginalize emotion. It needs to be central.
This was sort of the keynote address, Ed, and you are the person who thinks differently. And my conclusion is we need more physicians who had an undergraduate degree in African history. because I think there is something to that about how we select people who have tended to go through the scientific math orientation, and we need more anthropologists and philosophy majors and individuals of that nature, which brings us back to the point you just made, which is behavioral interviewing is really critical to how we select people throughout the organization, and certainly pertinent to our graduate medical education choices. And so just a tremendously stimulating morning, and thank you very much.
Thanks.